First, we have Representative Lou Lang. He was first elected to the Illinois House of Representatives in 1988. He represents the 16th District, and we reside in the 16th District here. And the 16th District includes Lincolnwood, Morton Grove, Skokie, and portions of this neighborhood. And Representative Lang currently serves as the Deputy Majority Leader in the House and has fought for economic development, working families, civil rights, and health care and Medicaid reform. He's received numerous awards and recognition for his work. He was named Legislator of the Year by the Illinois Hospital Association, the Illinois Council on Senior Citizens, the Service Employees Union, and the Illinois Public Action Council, among others. So welcome, Representative Lang. Sarah Karp, who is in the middle there. If any of you are familiar with Catalyst Chicago, you are familiar with Sarah Karp. She joined the staff of Catalyst Chicago in 2006 after writing for 5 years for Catalyst's sister publication, The Chicago Reporter, where she covered children and family issues. Before that, she was a project director at Youth Communication, which publishes New Expression, a newspaper written by and for teenagers. She has also reported for the Daily Southtown and the Columbia, Missouri Daily Tribune. Her beats on the Catalyst are high school special education, elementary school core instruction, desegregation, health and social services, and children of the incarcerated. And a recent article of Sarah's was about the schools are still dirty with privatized custodians. Principals say, a lot of us read that and heard more about it on WBEZ. I don't know if you did, but you might want to check it out. And then finally, we have Ralph Martier. He is the Executive Director of the Center for Tax and Budget Accountability, which was formed in 2000 to be a bipartisan nonprofit research and advocacy think tank that works across ideological lines to promote social and economic justice for everyone, from traditionally disadvantaged populations to the middle class. He also teaches a master's class on education, finance, and fiscal policy for the University of Illinois and Roosevelt University, where he is also a distinguished lecturer on public policy. He has also taught fiscal policy seminars for various universities and the International Fulbright Scholar Program. He has received numerous awards for his work on education policy reform. He serves on the school board of River Forest District 90, and it's an elected school board, and I would like to remind all the public officials here that WERBCO is definitely behind the elected school board in Chicago. It has such a nice ring to it, elected school board. And he also writes for the State Journal Register and the Daily Herald. So welcome again to our panelists. All right. Representative Lang, if you'd like to do a little bit more introduction for yourself, there's a microphone there if you want to use that.
Good evening to all of you. Are we on? Good evening to all of you. It's a great pleasure to be here with you. It's always good to have that introduction done because I know there's going to be applause at least one time during the evening. I've been in the Illinois House for 27 years. I'm sure most of you know that I've represented this community that entire time. It's a labor of love. I love what I do. We're here to talk about education funding. Education funding is probably the most important thing we have to deal with in the state of Illinois. For years, I've been saying that we don't do it well enough. We don't reform it the way we ought to. We don't fund schools the way we should. Where I live in Skokie, 4% of the money we get comes from the state of Illinois. The rest comes from property taxes. In other communities, it's different. But that 4% that we get from the state is very valuable. We can't do without it to provide the quality of education that we wish to provide to our students. Same thing in the city of Chicago. The numbers may be different, but the results are the same. We all have a stake in having a better system of education for our kids. There are numerous bills in Springfield from time to time to deal with the issue of education funding. The one that hits you between the eyes most quickly is a bill called Senate Bill 1. It's the cousin of last year's Senate Bill 16. And this is, in short, an effort by Senator Menard from downstate to, in essence, play Robin Hood, to take from school districts that have some money and give it to school districts that don't. It sounds great if you're a downstate legislator and your property tax base is low and your assessed value is low and you need more money for your schools. Let's reach up to Chicago and get it. Let's reach up to the Chicago suburbs and get it. But the fact is, that's unfair. It is true that there is an inequity and an inequality in education funding around the state of Illinois. No one would deny that. But my view is that the way to achieve that equality is not to take from those who are doing well and give it to others, because if you do that, everybody ends up with a mediocre education and nobody has enough money. The way to do it is to keep people where they are that are doing well and find ways to find new dollars to improve the lot in life of the schools that aren't doing so well, particularly in rural Illinois, central and southern Illinois. Senator Menard's effort to move Senate Bill 16 last year came out of the Senate, did not move in the House, and Senate Bill 1, I presume, will move out of the Senate as well, and that bill probably won't move in the House. However, it's also fair to say that members of the House do feel like we should reform the education funding formula. Not only the formula, but reform of the whole system. For years, I had a bill called the Fund Education First Act. And what that bill said was simple. It said that the Constitution required that the state be the predominant and primary funding source for public education in the state of Illinois, but we've never done it. We've never gotten to 50%, which is, I think, what most people think that means. In fact, our prorations are now at 89% of the amount we've been allotted, which isn't 50% of what you need. Saying in another way, we don't give you enough money and then we take 11% off the top of the money we promised you. It makes it very difficult for the city of Chicago to educate their kids. It makes it very difficult for people all around the state of Illinois to educate their kids. The backdrop to all of this in today's life in Springfield is a state budget that's a mess. When the state income tax reverted back to 3.75%, it cost us something like $6 billion. Well, wouldn't you know it, the difference between what members of the General Assembly are prepared to spend in the next fiscal year and what the governor of the state of Illinois wants to spend in the next fiscal year is, you guessed it, around $6 billion. And therein will lie the budget battle this year. Funding education this year will be completely dependent on how that budget battle goes in Springfield. Who will win that budget battle? Will the General Assembly win that budget battle, which is predominated by people who want to do a better job funding schools? Or will the governor win that budget battle? He will tell you, he told you in the campaign, and he'll tell you in his rhetoric, that he's not interested in cutting schools. He's only interested in cutting all other things so that he can put more money into schools. But the fact is that he just signed a bill that cut education for fiscal year 15. And so as we move forward to look at fiscal year 16, please remember that the budget document is not just about education. While that's the most important section of the state budget to most of us in this room, particularly to those of us who have children in schools, the education portions of that budget will be directly dependent on how we do managing the funds we have and what we do with the rest of the budget. Will we have a tax increase? We don't know. If we have a tax increase, will the money be devoted to education, or at least a major portion of it to be devoted to education? We don't know. What will we do with human services while we're trying to fund schools? How will we take care of the health care needs and the needs of senior citizens, those who are disabled with mental illness, those who need adult daycare, those who are drug addicted? How are we going to do all those things with $6 billion less than we had last year and still do a better job funding schools? So if you have answers to all those questions, you ought to come down to Springfield and join us. because we're looking for answers to those questions. Rest assured that the members of the House and Senate are looking very carefully at these numbers, and as we move forward the next 6 weeks to an adjournment date, which is scheduled for May 31st, but will never happen, we need to find out how we're going to be able to fund the budget so that we can determine what portion of that money will go to education. I'm happy to be here with you and look forward to your questions.
Hi. So as Ms. Chulov said, I'm Sarah Karp. I work with a publication called Catalyst Chicago. We're a 25-year-old publication that covers schools in the city. So my main, one of the main things that I do is every year I analyze, look at, try to explain, try to make sense of the Chicago Public School budget and how it relates to schools here. You know, basically we get money from the state and we get property taxes and we get some federal money, and federal money is the smallest sliver of money. The state is then the next big chunk, and then property taxes. About 40% of our budget comes from property taxes. The way the schools get funded in Chicago is that we do something called student-based budgeting, and this is something that's relatively new to Chicago. A few years ago we changed from a system that said, okay, this is how many kids that you have in your school, and we're going to divide that by 31 students, and that's how many teachers you get. And so there's a lot of variation in that, because if you were a few down or a few up, you'd still get that teacher. Well, now what we do is we basically attach money to a student. And so the amount that we attach to the student sort of varies every year. 2 years ago, it was very low, and you heard probably around town, or if any of you guys are involved in the local schools were crying, crying bloody murder, because they were cut, you know, hundreds of thousands of dollars. And especially schools in some of the wealthier areas saw some of the bigger cuts, because some of those schools were getting little extra pots of money over time, just because, let's say, there was a grant funded like 5 or 6 years ago. Well, the old Mayor Daley and Arne Duncan, the last CEO, were kind of strategic in that what they would do is they would say, okay, you got this extra kindergarten position in 2000. We're not going to cut that kindergarten position. So a lot of schools had these like extra people hanging around that really weren't part of their per pupil budget. But when they implemented student-based budgeting, all that went away. And so what you had is you had, you know, what's supposed to be an equalizing of the system, but some people were like, I didn't know we were so unequal, and they had hundreds of thousands of dollars cut from their budget. You know, one thing that you have to keep in mind is that while, you know, I understand the argument that, you know, there's some rich districts and we shouldn't take away from rich districts. The Education Trust, which is a very respected organization out of D.C., just found that Illinois has the biggest gap between wealthiest districts and poor districts in the entire country. And so, you know, that's one of the issues when you look at Chicago. We're, you know, we're really, really struggling with the amount of money that is really too low to educate kids, especially given that almost every study shows that in order to educate poor kids, you need almost double the amount that you need for rich kids. And yet here, we have, you know, sometimes half as much. So there's a big issue. Here in Chicago, the amount that we get, that schools get per child, is between about $4,600 for elementary school students and about $5,400 per high school students. On top of that, schools get money for administrators. They get money for poor kids. They get money for special education students. They get a whole bunch, you know, they get some money on top of that student-based budgeting. So, you know, you're really not ending up with $4,000, but that's the base. And so 2 years ago, the first year of student-based budgeting, the money was very low, and a lot of people saw cuts. Now last year, we saw an increase of about $250 per student. Now remember, this was going into an election year. The way that this was funded was that, and it's a very difficult thing to explain, but basically what they did was they said that for this 1 year only, we're gonna count three property tax revenue cycles in one budget. So we're gonna sort of shift our fiscal year to be 15 months instead of 12 months. And then we're gonna use that extra one that's gonna come, because the property tax usually comes in between August and September. We're gonna use that extra little bit of money and put it towards this one year. Now, this, I guess, works fine, but it's not a long-term solution, because you're only gonna be able to count three once, right? But also, if ever that property tax, that last property tax, which the third one, which at one point did not come, I guess the county got better at dispersing the property tax in a more timely manner. But if that ever doesn't happen, then we're like totally screwed, because then we could have a year with only one property tax revenue. But they did it, going into an election year, they needed to figure out some way to balance their budget. By state law, you have to balance your budget, so that's what they did. So they added $250 per student. Now, right now is usually the time that principals would be getting their school-based budgets, but that's not gonna happen till after the election. So not until at least 2 weeks from now, 2 or 3 weeks from now. And people are really, really, really nervous about what that's gonna be, because now we got 4 years before an election. As you guys, I'm sure, have heard, we have a huge pension payment due this year, as we did last year, as we will for the coming years. And we have, Chicago Public Schools has a huge debt issue. One thing that you should keep in mind is that per student, we're now paying about CPS is now paying about $2,000 per student for debt, just debt payments. And that's a lot of money, and it's growing every year. I can talk about, I'll end here, but one thing that I know almost everybody that I ever talk to wants to know about is, why does it seem like charter schools are funded better than traditional CPS schools? And I can talk a little bit about how that funding works if you guys want.
Good evening. I'm Ralph Martiri. I'm executive director of a bipartisan organization, which means my board of directors neither likes nor trusts each other very much. And that's a great thing for my organization, because it allows us on staff to work on best practices and data. So frankly, we don't give a rip if a particular solution is left wing, right wing, or somewhere in the middle. If it follows best practices, if it's evidence and data based, if it meets demographically driven needs, that's what you should do. And leave your ideological worldview at the door. My role in education is pretty deep on education finance, both here in the state of Illinois and nationally. So I'll talk nationally first. I just served 2 years as a full voting commissioner on the Federal Excellence and Equity Commission in the Civil Rights Division of the Department of Education, appointed by the president and Arne Duncan. And our job was to look at systems of finance in U.S. education to see if they were contributing to achievement gaps and or other problems. They are. And in fact, America does not follow anything close to a best practice. And we issued a report in February of 2013 called For Each and Every Child, which includes pretty much a nice laundry list of how you move America's education system from where it is today to one that provides every child in the country a meaningful opportunity to learn. And I'm going to tell you one thing that may surprise you, but maybe not. The American public education system has not forgotten how to educate children. It is just under-resourced to educate children in low-income and increasingly minority and middle-class communities. At the state level, I've been working on education funding reform since my organization was founded in 2000. We were, in 2001 or two, appointed as the technical advisor to a then standing bipartisan committee in the House on property tax and education funding reform, and charged with the real simple mission: gee, does the state need either of those things? And if it does, what should it look like? Well, we do, and we do for a number of reasons. The Education Trust Study, this isn't the first time Illinois has received a failing grade in educational equity. Every single year, when compared to other states, Illinois is in the bottom three states in education funding equity, bottom three in the nation. Now, that should horrify you, because we have the fifth largest economy of any state in the nation, over $720 billion economy. If we were an independent country, that would be the 19th largest economy in the world. It's a larger economy than Saudi Arabia, Ireland, Greece, Norway, Colombia, Nigeria. You may have heard of a couple of these places. And a state with that resource base should not have any problem finding a sustainable and equitable way to fund education to the level it needs to be funded to provide this opportunity to kids. So, number one, we are very inequitable. Number two, the reason for that is we over-rely on property taxes to fund schools. In fact, based on NCES data, the National Center on Education Statistics, we rank number one in the country in the portion of education funding covered by property taxes. Overall, 63% of education funding in Illinois is covered by property taxes. The national average is 43%, which means the state of Illinois ranks dead last in the country, 50th in the portion of education funding covered by state-based resources. We only cover 28% of education funding at the state level. The national average is 46, 47%. The feds make up the difference, roughly 10, 11%. So we've effectively tied the quality of public education a child receives to the property wealth of the community in which the kid lives. Now, that's a real problem, because I teach a master's class on fiscal policy, but here's the basic rule of fiscal policy that everyone needs to deal with. Where needs are greatest, resources are least. So if you tie your fiscal system to local resources, what you are basically doing is denying access to opportunity to low-income populations, and you're ensuring poverty will continue. So how do we fix it? The answers are actually pretty clear if you don't have to vote on it in Springfield. So we've run the numbers for the state. We do have a pretty significant accumulated deficit right now. So our general fund is roughly $35 billion. But $11 billion, $12 billion of that is spent before they take a vote. Those are hard costs over which there are no discretion. There's three categories there. There's your debt service, there's your pension payment, and something called statutory transfers out. The two biggest ones are those, the local government distributive fund, where the state shares its income tax revenue with local governments. That's about $1 billion of the $2 billion statutory transfers out. And the other biggest part is the Medicaid transfers that are required by law, because it's a jointly funded federal-state program that we have to put into Medicaid trust funds. That leaves about $24 billion for current services. And $9 out of $10 there go to education, health, social services, and public safety. That's your budget. So when you hear about across-the-board cuts, the reason you're hearing that is politicians don't want you to understand what the board is. So let me be very clear. It is education, it is healthcare, it is social services and human and public safety. So if you're gonna cut your way to funding schools, you are cutting human services, healthcare, and public safety. That's what you gotta cut. The reason we have such a problem funding those items and public education is our revenue and our revenue system isn't designed to work in a modern economy. Our tax policy is, and this is a fiscal term, I hope it's not too technical, mishugana. Doesn't work. So, two or three little reforms will solve all our fiscal problems. And I'm gonna tell you what they are right now. We need to expand the state's sales tax base to include consumer services. Not business to business, not healthcare, just consumer services. If we did that, the state would net roughly $2.5 billion in new revenue. Number two, we need to include some retirement income in our income tax base. 41 states in America have an income tax. We are one of only three that excludes all retirement income from taxation. The feds don't even do that. Now, you don't want to harm low-income seniors, so we have modeled it out where if an individual taxpayer or family taxpayer unit's adjusted gross income is $50,000 or less, none of their retirement income would be taxable. Between $50,000 and $75,000, only 25%, and then you phase it in. So literally, taxpayers wouldn't be paying 100% of the income tax on their retirement income until they have $150,000 a year in total AGI. If we did that at the old 5% rate, we would generate about $1.2 billion in revenue. So now you're up at about $4 billion in new revenue, which is a magic number. That's sort of what we need to solve our problems. And then the final thing you need to do, sorry to mention pensions, is to re-amortize the debt we owe the pension systems. Because I want to be very clear, we don't have a pension problem in Illinois, we have a debt service problem. Because for decades, to paper over the mismatch between tax revenue growth and service cost growth, the structural imbalance we have, the state simply borrowed against what it owed the pension systems and used that borrowed money to subsidize the delivery of education, health, social services, and public safety that we all consumed. So taxpayers in Illinois for over 50 years have never actually paid the full cost of the services they're consuming. The pensions have subsidized it. Then they wrote an IOU to the pension system that bore interest, compounding annually. And we're now paying that back. So if you look at the pension payment scheduled for this coming year, fiscal year 2016, it's $6.8 billion. Only $1.2 billion of that is the cost of the pensions. The rest is repaying the debt. That is what we have to fix. It ramps up. If we flatten that out and extended our payment period about 13 years. So instead of paying it off in 30 years, we paid it off in 43 years, and did those other two things. Within 2 years, the state could pay all its past due bills, all of them. And in year three, it could put $1 billion more in a public education. And by year five, have $4.5 billion more in a public education. And that is a magic number, because according to the evidence-based model, and what that is it looks at those practices which have a statistically meaningful correlation to enhancing student achievement over time, and it costs them out. Evidence-based model. The evidence-based model suggests that's what we need to solve our school funding problems in Illinois. So we'd be able to do that and put about another $250 million into social services and still balance our budget. So that's what we need to do. Those are where our problems are. I'm happy to answer questions.
Thank you for that really succinct presentation there. Okay, I'm going to begin and ask a question, and if some other people would like to ask them, you can line up near the microphone here, and please feel free to ask questions, because we don't want just WERPCO asking the questions. We would like to hear from the audience as well. Okay, Representative Lang, you're familiar with HB 390, I would assume, which could raise about $450 million by eliminating tax loopholes used by corporations to avoid paying taxes, and HB 3627, a corporate transparency bill favored by the Illinois Department of Revenue. As number three leader in the House Democratic majority, what will you do to get these two legislative bills passed into law to help alleviate Illinois' revenue problems? Will you work to support a constitutional amendment to for a progressive income tax?
That's a lot of questions. So first, I support both of those bills. We have major corporations in the state of Illinois that pay zero income tax to the state of Illinois. They make hundreds of millions of dollars, and due to all kinds of write-offs, et cetera, they pay zero income tax to the state of Illinois. There's something wrong with that. Additionally, we have provided many opportunities for corporations not to count their income. Some call them corporate loopholes. Now, what one person's loophole is another person's incentive, business incentive, to grow and to hire people. And so there's the rub with that bill. The idea is, how do you sit down at a table with people and negotiate what's really a loophole? I think all legislators are interested in getting rid of loopholes. Certain legislators see less loopholes than others. The goal is, how do you find a majority of the House and the Senate willing to decide what's a loophole and what isn't a loophole? So it sounds great to say loopholes. I'm for doing away with those loopholes. Relative to a progressive income tax, I've been a proponent of that since 1988. It's something we need to do. It'll provide more dollars for the state of Illinois. I'm a supporter of it. I'm a co-sponsor of it, but it isn't going to happen. To make a progressive income tax happen in Illinois, you've got to have a constitutional amendment. To have a constitutional amendment, you need a 3/5 majority in both chambers of the House and Senate, and you need a 3/5 vote of the people of the state of Illinois on the ballot. The latter part, I don't think, is a problem, but getting this through the House and the Senate is the problem. Not every member of the House, not every member of the Senate favors a progressive income tax. Now, the good news is that the governor, who would not support a progressive income tax, doesn't have to sign that. That's just a resolution that has to be passed in both chambers. So it's not as a bill where a governor would have to sign it. But we do not today have sufficient votes in either chamber to pass a progressive income tax. Some years ago, we tried to pass one, and it failed miserably, partly because some were philosophically opposed to it, but partly because the bill that, or the resolution that we had at that time, was poorly drafted. And while I voted for it, I didn't think it was well done. And so we need what we need if we're going to have a progressive income tax is a lot less talk and a lot more action. So there's a lot of groups around the state of Illinois who want to talk about a progressive income tax. And here's how they talk about it. They get in a room like this with a bunch of people who agree with them, and they wring their hands and they say, oh my goodness, my goodness, my gracious, we need a progressive income tax. And then they leave the room and they go home. And the next time they talk about a progressive income tax again is next month at the meeting with the same group. And they wring their hands again and they go home and they say, oh, woe is us, why aren't we getting a progressive income tax passed? The answer is, you're only advocating among yourselves. So for those in the room, and don't raise your hands, who support a progressive income tax, who have you called? What legislators have you called? What legislators out of your own area, where maybe you have a cousin that lives in downstate Illinois who has someone, a legislator who's opposed to it, have you called that cousin? Have you asked that cousin to call his or her legislator? My guess is most of you have not done that. And most advocates don't do that. So. What I found is, and this is a great something for political scientists to take a look at, I find that the people who are most firmly entrenched with their points of view, people on the far right, people on the far left, they actually have one thing in common. They don't do nothing. They talk. They talk. If you want to change Illinois, if you want to pass these kinds of measures like a progressive income tax, if you want to really make a difference, people have to do more than talk. They even have to do more than elect the best candidate in their neighborhood, although that's a really good start and that's a really good thing to do. You have to do more. You have to spread your wings and talk to some people who will tell you no, and then deal with the issue of how to convince them to say yes. That's how you change Illinois.
Thank you. Question?
Sarah, I was hoping you could speak to the charter schools. And my one other question was that I have some friends who are teachers, and they've mentioned that one of the big new jobs of teachers is grant writing for, you know, private grants or additional government grants, and also putting together fundraisers with the parents and local businesses where their school is located to raise additional funds for the school. I imagine that's not a big part of the budget, but it's like a second responsibility of the teachers they do between, you know, 4 and 8 p.m. every night. So if you can talk about that.
Well, funny you ask about that, because I'm actually working on an article looking at private fundraising in schools, not only in traditional district-run schools, but also in charter schools. Because even though it's not, you know, maybe the biggest part of their budget, private money can be used any way that you want to use it. And so it becomes a very valuable thing, because a lot of the money that CPS gives to schools is money that's already spoken for. I mean, you can't take money that's allocated for a regular classroom teacher and say, oh, well, today I'm just going to decide I want a librarian. It would be difficult to do that. So the thing that's powerful about private money is that, yeah, you can buy that librarian. And this is something that's really changed over the last decade. I actually did a story about private fundraising in 2007, and then only about 20 schools were raising more than $50,000. Now, and I'm not done with I'm working on this story, but I've looked up about 300 tax forms from private groups that do fundraising for schools, and I've already found about 80 that have more than $100,000. So this is becoming a much, and when you have $100,000, what you wind up doing is, that's a teacher's salary. And when you look at some of them, they are raising money for especially things like language, art, gym, technology, all the reasons why you walk into a school and you say, why is this so different than the school, you know, six blocks away that should be getting the exact same amount of money? Charter schools also, you know, they sort of were founded on the idea that they were going to bring in the business community, bring in philanthropists, and, you know, a lot of the charter schools in the city are actually named after philanthropists. I mean, Rauner has a charter school. There's, you know, there's a couple different ones that are named after different philanthropists, businessmen who also give a lot of money, and that does make a big difference in what they have to spend. Some charter schools have as much as 25% of their budget is actually raised by private money. So it plays a big role. There's a danger in that, and that's that, you know, philanthropy sometimes gets tired of you. And if you're basing all your budget on philanthropy, you can be in big trouble. There's one charter school called the Learn Charter School Network that was given a big angel grant by Oprah like 6 or 7 years ago. Well, now, and so their big thing was small class sizes, and they had really good results. But now that money's gone, what do? They can't support those smaller class sizes. So can they maintain what they, you know, what they've been selling? As far as CPS, I mean, CPS will say that the base per pupil for charter schools and traditional schools is exactly the same. But charter schools are given some extra pots of money. One thing that they're given is that CPS sort of says, okay, we give a bunch of in-kind money to traditional schools. So, for example, if there's a legal problem at a traditional school, they can call legal downtown, CPS legal. But at a charter school, you can't call CPS legal. You got to call your own lawyer. So they somehow, and this is one of the places where like sort of the mincemeat is made, that I don't really know all the details, but somehow they put together all the in-kind services that they give to school, to traditional schools, and they came up with a figure of about $2,000. So on top of the base of, you know, about between $4,600 and $5,100 that all schools get, they give charter schools an extra $2,000 per kid. This is per kid. On top of that, then they also, and this is actually a really, it sounds like a small amount of money, but they give an extra $99 per kid to every charter school for what they call a teacher adjustment. So a very small number of schools in Chicago get extra money because when we went to student-based budgeting, there was a big fear that veteran teachers would be fired, because now that you have a pot of money, it makes more sense. If principals want to stretch their budget more, they're going to, you know, hire the least experienced teachers who get paid the least. So in order to sort of mitigate those fears, CPS said, we're going to give the schools that have higher than the average experience level a little extra money. Well, for some reason, charter schools, which by and large have way less experienced teachers and way higher turnover than traditional CPS schools, for some reason, they get, all of them get extra money for the same thing. I don't know exactly why. And then also charter schools get an extra $500 on top of that for to hire principal and those type of positions too. And CPS traditional schools also do get they get a principal and assistant principal and a clerk. So that's basically how they're funded. So CPS would say it's equal. The people in traditional schools would say, well, that doesn't sound so equal to me. The people in charter schools would say that they actually, up until very recently, would maintain that they're underfunded. Because they say not only do they have all these expenses that traditional schools don't have, but they also pay for facilities, which can wind up being a big price tag. But there was a state commission last year that was meeting last year and came out with a study that said, we've decided that charter schools are funded equally. So, you know, I'm sure that doesn't, you know, calm, make everybody, you know, say, okay, now we understand, but everybody's got a different opinion on it. I think now that you have student-based budgeting, you at least have a little more transparency in how charters are getting their budget as, you know, as compared to traditional CPS schools.
Sarah, with student-based budgeting, if students transfer, does the money follow the student from school to school, even between traditional school, public schools and charter schools?
Well, just last year, a bill was passed that said that had to happen. And before last year, what would happen is that there was, you know, enrollment audits, and so basically whoever you had in your seat on the day of the enrollment audit, which was the 20th day of school, that's who you got your money for. But now this bill says that, you know, the money has to follow the student. There's a lot of concern that, you know, like the day after the enrollment audit, the charter schools are like adios to the kids that, you know, maybe weren't gonna give, you know, help them meet high test scores. But how that's gonna work, I think people are really, really concerned, because not only on the charter school level, but also on the traditional school level, there's just a lot of mobility, and people are just really concerned about, well, how do you really make the money follow the student? You know, it's not as easy as it sounds.
Okay, thank you. Go ahead.
I have two questions. Ralph, I'd like you to address the idea of your sales tax and how the burden of that would fall on the various segments of the population, whether that would be considered progressive or aggressive. And then Sarah, I would ask, Chicago Public Schools have had a big push lately to try to increase the high school graduation rate. And one of the components of that is to have a lot of, I think they are actually, for-profit organizations coming in and offering a program which appears to be giving about one-fourth as much time to the students, and then graduating them and saying they graduated from their original high school. Could you address the funding of those after Ralph answers his question? Thank you.
Moderately regressive. So, I mean, that's the answer. It's moderately regressive, but our current system is more regressive because low-income populations buy a lot more products than do high-income populations, and high-income populations consume a lot more services. But that's almost irrelevant. I mean, it's funny, every time I'm on a panel with Lou Lang, and Lou, the last time was like 4 or 5 years ago, it was another school-related thing. I think it was the League of Women Voters. But I mean, you know, listen to him. His advice is wonderful. And in particular, I'm always learning something whenever Lou speaks at one of these things. But really, your advice to this group to not talk to each other, but get out and talk to people that say no, is precisely right. And that doesn't happen, and I wish more folks gave that kind of guidance. So Lou, you know, kudos to you. On the regressivity of the tax, it's moderately regressive, but here's the choice. You either have a moderately regressive tax or you have a woefully underfunded school. The economic differential in value to the low-income family, if you have a choice between a service cut or a regressive tax, you pick the regressive tax every single time. Because maybe a regressive tax will cost a low-income family 50 to 150 bucks a year, which is hard. That takes food off the table. I mean, that's not insignificant. What's the loss of childcare cost? $4,000? They can't replace that. What's the value of having an adequately funded education to their kids and their future? Average earnings, tens of thousands of dollars a year. So it really, if it's a choice, it's a no-brainer. That's number one. Number two, we do, as Lou Lang pointed out, have a constitutional requirement to have a flat income tax. And the easiest way in a perfect world to have a more progressive system is to have a rate structure that modifies itself predicated on ability to pay. But you could always build progressivity into a fiscal system, irrespective of these problems, with intelligent tax policy, like the earned income tax credit. This is a refundable tax credit. So what does refundable mean? It means, let's say I'm a low income person, I owe the state $100 in income taxes, but I qualify for a $200 earned income tax credit. Well, 200 is more than 100, I don't have to pay my income taxes, right? They're gone. I get a check for the extra $100. That's the refundability feature. What does that do? That takes into account all the other taxes I pay, sales, property, excise, et cetera, right? So through the income tax, you have a very facile way to provide targeted relief to the populations you want to provide tax relief to, while still appropriately taxing your base like you should. And I actually drafted the state's earned income tax credit bill for a senator. He's no longer around. He's frankly become irrelevant to me, a guy named Barack Obama. I don't know if you remember him when he was here, but I drafted that bill for Barack, and it eventually passed. And it's really good policy, but you could have a refundable credit go up to higher levels of income. Our research suggests that you go up to about $60,000 a year, which is far beyond the EITC. And provide very special targeted tax relief to low-income families while still taxing the way you need to tax. Because the thing about tax policy is there's a couple of different principles. One is fairness and one stability. Well, they don't run in parallel paths, they conflict. Your stable taxes are your unfair taxes. But you need your stable taxes to fund services. So you gotta create a balancing act. It's like balancing a portfolio for your individual investments.
Oh, I appreciate you asking questions about the for-profit alternative schools. That actually was mine and Becky Vivi's story. So it was a joint investigation by Catalyst and WBZ. And basically, under this current CPS administration, very quietly they opened already 16 of these new alternative schools. Most of them are computer-based, so kids go, and in fact there's one that's proposed to open right in Lincoln Square, where kids go to a storefront, they sit down in front of a computer, and they do a lesson, and if they need some help, they call over a teacher who can help them. Some of them, the one that's trying to open in Lincoln Square, they only have to go 2 days a week. Now, for-profit schools are actually illegal in Illinois. No charter schools are for-profit, and in Illinois, in fact, and in Chicago, we don't even have many for-profits that manage charter schools. So in a lot of other states, what's happened with charter schools is that these companies, the contract will go to a not-for-profit, but then they'll contract with a for-profit, and that for-profit will basically run the school and take pretty good margins. But what Chicago Public Schools did is they, instead of giving them, instead of making them charter schools or contract schools, because they couldn't, they made them like a unit, like a contract through a department. So the department gets the money, and that department, sort of like how we contract with somebody to buy toilet paper, or we contract with somebody to buy, cleaning supplies. But in this case, it's a for-profit school. Some of these companies, even though they have very limited hours, they make profit is that they have two, sometimes three sessions a day. So kids only have to go for 2 or 3 hours a day. And they then can have one teacher, cover, three students in one day. So that, that makes it very lucrative. They also are pretty easy to get credits. I mean, we found some kids, they're like, oh yeah, in 2 weeks I got a credit. Oh yeah, I worked really hard, and I did it in 3 days. Now, mind you, that you can, in most years, kids only get between 4 and 6 credits a year in high school, and these kids are getting them like in 2 or 3 weeks. So it's a very sort of questionable situation. And then because they're just contracts and they're not actual schools, they can't give out diplomas. So the way that the CPS got around this is they give the kid the diploma from their home neighborhood school. So even though they might have never stepped foot into, Mather or Senn or Sullivan, there's some kids that are getting diplomas through these things and through these operations, and they're not going to that school. And some of the principals some of the high school principals had no idea this was going on, and were actually pretty, in the way that they have to be very political, they were shocked. They were like, really? I had no idea. And some of these places, they really are sort of interesting. One of them is called Magic Johnson Bridgescapes. They're run by Edison Learning. Magic Johnson is being paid like a branding fee of, I think about, well, you know, these are private corporations. It's very hard to get financial information about them. But I think he's getting $500,000 per school to just have his name on it. You know, some of the documents that we found indicate that, though he wouldn't answer. I was able to ask him some questions. He would not answer how much he's getting. And this organization is, Edison Learning is the one that created the curriculum, and they're paying themselves like $500,000 per school for the curriculum that they created. Now, you know, these are like schools with maybe, you know, 200-300 kids. A traditional neighborhood school might get $50,000 for a curriculum for an entire year for, you know, way more students. So the way CPS explains it is that if, you know, they're helping raise the graduation rate, these kids didn't fit in a traditional school, it's better to give them a diploma than to just let them walk around without a diploma. I'm really sort of interested that so far no state lawmakers have really looked at this. I mean, there's several things in state law says the school kids are supposed to be in classes for 300 minutes a day. Some of these schools don't even operate for, you know, the kids are only there for 2 or 3 hours and not even every day of the week. So how are those kids in class for 300 minutes a day? I think there's some questionable things going on.
Yeah, and just one other thing. They might have a high school diploma, but they're not college or career ready. Our statistics in Illinois are horrible, and I'm sorry, I don't remember the exact statistic, but I think it's somewhere around 32 to 38% of our kids graduate high school, college, and career ready. So the kids who don't and go to a community college go immediately into those remedial programs, which chew up all their financial aid and MAP grants, and they have a much higher dropout rate because they can't stay in school long enough to complete the 2-year degree because they're spending all their money on remedial to become college and career ready. So the push to bump up graduation rates without ensuring the kids that are graduating are in fact college and career ready is a meaningless thing. It doesn't help the kids, and it really doesn't prepare them to be competitive in a modern economy.
Thank you. Representative Lang, do you know if anybody in the state legislature will be looking into the problem with those schools that Sarah mentioned?
Well, there will be now.
Yeah. Good to know. Okay, thank you. Go ahead, please.
I was interested, Ms. Carpenter, in the $5,000 that follows the student into the school and the $2,000 that goes to the banks. And I understand that almost $15,000 comes into the system for the student. And I was wondering where the other $8,000 goes. In particular, I was wondering about the amounts for testing.
Well, there's a good story is how much we're spending on testing, especially this year, because it's not only we're spending money, well, the state is paying for a big chunk of park, but there's a lot of auxiliary costs of park, and then we also are implementing the NWEA and then Dibbles and X, Y, and Z. So there's a lot of money that goes into testing. You know, the thing is that, so the $5,000 is the base. There's a lot of other money. So for example, if you have poor kids, you're gonna get an extra amount per poor kid, an extra amount per special education student, an extra amount per bilingual kid. So there's no school that is actually only getting $5,000 per student. That's the base. So probably on average, schools are getting about $8,000 per student. And I believe like that's about the amount that we say, that if you look at the state report card, it says the instructional amount's about 8,000 some change. I'm not exactly sure, but it's about 8,000. And then if you look at the operation of the school district, that's where you're finding your cost for debt and then also like your capital costs and things like that. So that's where you kind of make up that money.
But you can't be specific about
Testing, you know, I haven't done that analysis, and I will put it on the list. It's something that people often mention. You know, it's worth looking at. Yes.
Hi, I have lots of questions, but I'll only ask two. First one is for Ralph. There's been talk from different groups for taxing pennies on the dollar, financial transaction taxes. A downtown lawyer acquaintance of mine says, if you did that, you force all the financial institutions downtown to leave the state. I don't know how true that is, but I was wondering what you thought about financial transaction tax or fee. And what would you answer that? And then I'll ask my other question.
Okay, great for the federal government. It'll never happen at the state level. And devote your efforts to fixing those portions of tax policy that actually have a political chance. And that's my honest feeling on the financial transactions tax. Illinois has historically been one of the lowest taxing states in the nation. Up until our temporary tax increase, despite having the fifth largest population and the fifth largest economy, we consistently ranked between 47th and 42nd every single year in total state and local tax burden as a percentage of income. We will simply never be a tax outlier on the new fangled big hit business hard tax. Never happen politically in Illinois. Second, I think it'd be awful hard to enforce it. I think that a financial transactions tax at the state level would disadvantage us economically. I think at the federal level, it's brilliant public policy and it should be done. But at the state level, if we just fixed those taxes that people are familiar with, the income and sales, which are your core revenue generators for state government in all 50 states, we can solve our problem. And that's really where grassroots effort needs to be devoted, rather than chasing something that, yeah, it could generate a bunch of money, but it literally has no political viability, and it frankly raises some pretty serious economic and policy concerns.
Thank you. The next question, I think, is for Representative Lang. As far as I understand, charter schools only half the and it might have changed, so I don't know, but only half the teachers need to be certified. The principal doesn't have to know anything about education to be a principal, just has to be connected, I guess. And what I wonder about is also a professor from University of Minnesota testified to the House Committee on Education that charter schools by their very nature are separate and unequal institutions. And yet I wonder to what extent the state, oh, and I have the transcript on that, Amanda sent it to me, thank you. But I wonder to what extent, because I know to a certain extent, the state does finance charter schools, and I don't know how much that is, but I know that the state does. Thank you.
Well, I'm not sure where the question was in there.
How much does the state fund charter schools?
So I don't have that dollar amount, but let's talk about charter schools generally. Let's just get this on the table. I'm not a fan of charter schools. There's a lot of reasons for it. First, let's start from the end and work backwards. Most charter schools aren't any better than the public schools that surround them. There are some that are, just like there are some public schools that are better than other public schools. But generally speaking, the charter school experiment has not worked in the state of Illinois. So let me start with that. One of the reasons it doesn't work is it doesn't require certified teachers. Now, the original thought when people talked about charter schools was, well, here's a good idea. If we want to teach kids about computers, we'll get a computer expert in here. If we want to teach kids how to tumble, we'll get a professional tumbler in here. But none of these people know how to teach. And so if you put someone in front of 30 kids and you say, teach them how to do A, B, and C, if they haven't been trained as a teacher, then they're probably not going to be a good teacher. And so the results of those charter schools have not been good. There have been a number of bills, particularly the last couple of years, to put barriers in front of charter schools to grow, to put barriers in front of them in terms of their funding, to put barriers in front of them in terms of siphoning money off from the public schools. We've had some success in this area, but not complete success. If, and this is a big if we ever got to the point where public schools in Illinois were fully, properly funded, and somebody wanted to say, well, let's start some experimental schools with whatever money we have left over and give that a shot, I would say, go ahead and do it. But we've got thousands of kids going to substandard schools, having substandard education. And one more thing about charter schools, there's this big rush for some parents to take their kids out of the regular public school and put them into the public charter school. What does that do? It, in essence, dumbs down the population of that regular old public school. So you siphon off the best and brightest. Who do those kids in that school have to learn from? Who will the leaders in those schools be in the student population? Where will the appropriate socialization skills come from if the leaders and the best and the brightest of the kids are shuffled off to other schools? And so not only have charter schools been a failure in my view, but the charter school experiment has actually made regular public schools lesser for it. And so we would agree, David.
Yes. Ralph, you talked a lot about taxation. I was just wondering if there's any state in the country that you think does it right, that has a balance, is a good balance for their state services, education, et cetera?
Well, virtually every state does it better than us. So we don't really have to look very far. You know, Maryland, Massachusetts, Minnesota, these are leaders. California, frankly, had just went through some reforms and raised a ton of revenue. They increased their taxes more than any other state, and everyone said, millionaires are gonna run screaming out of here. No. California's economy is now growing, I think, second fastest in the entire nation, and they have net immigration of millionaires in. So really, there's a lot of states you can look at, but the truth is what you have to do is design tax policy to meet your own demographics and your own industry, and it's a correct mixture of your sales and income taxes at the state level, and that's what we've gotten really wrong. I want to pile on the charters, because Lou Lang is exactly right, and he raised a lot of the biggest issues. And let me tell you what we learned at the national level. Every OECD nation that did the same thing that the US did, adopted a competitive model with punitive accountability metrics, has seen their performance on the international PISA exams decline over the last decade. Every single OECD nation. It is us, it's New Zealand, it's Australia, it's Japan. Boom, down. Nations like OECD, the big industrial nations. The nations like Finland that went away from a competitive model altogether and built the capacity of their school systems to actually provide a quality education to every kid, irrespective of their income background, have seen their PISA exam scores go up. I mean, this isn't rocket science. We have a lot of evidence on it. And in charters in particular, they're problematic because they both cream and crop. They not only take the best kids out, they then just cut the kids that aren't performing to make their scores look artificially better. And even though they do that, only about roughly nationally 30% of them perform better than neighborhood schools. 70% perform equivalent or worse than neighborhood schools, despite taking the best students and creaming and cropping out the troublemakers. Unbelievable that that still has some credence. And the final thing is, on the whole competitive model in public education just doesn't work. Because for a competitive model to work, and I can't say I've had this lifelong dedication to peace or anything. If you really want to know my background, I was an evil corporate attorney for 15 years doing mergers and acquisitions in structured finance, and I was really good at it. So I am a private sector guy, I'm a business guy, I get competition, all that stuff. It's a horrible model for public education for the simple reason that for a competitive model to work, you must have winners and losers. In a public education system, you do not want losers. You want every single school to meet the needs of the children that walk in the door. It's that simple. So it's a very different model, and competition cannot work. And so this whole focus on charters is fundamentally flawed.
Thank you. Thank you.
So just a comment regarding the question Representative Lang said about charter schools. You could actually make a similar case about selective enrollment in magnet schools in the city as well, could you not? In terms of creating certain pupils off the top and then creating kind of a pool of poor performing students. That's my first question. Second question is for Ralph. And the three solutions that you've outlined, we know what we need to do. We can get out there and talk to more people who may disagree with us. From your perspective, from the messaging perspective, how do you sell it? How do you sell those three solutions that you advocate? And then finally, a comment. The way that the charter schools have been described earlier by you, Sarah, for me at least, it sounds like a racket. And in terms of the amount of money that's going from public funding into private hands, how do we stop that, I guess?
That's a lot of questions. So I'll start with the magnet school question. In some ways, you're right. Magnet schools do take some of the best and brightest out of the regular neighborhood public school, but there's a huge difference. A couple of huge differences. First, the magnet schools have certified teachers who are trained to teach children. That's the first and maybe most important. The other is that magnet schools have a purpose of taking the best and brightest and developing their minds in the same way we have a two statewide math and science academies in the state of Illinois that take public money and take the best and brightest of our students and help mold their minds and help make leaders out of them and help make help develop them into new entrepreneurs and people who will stay in Illinois and create businesses and make scientific discoveries and technology advances. So there's a difference between a charter school, which removes the best and brightest from the public schools just so they can say, look at us, we're a charter school, and a magnet school that takes the best and brightest and with a purpose to help those children. The charter schools take those children to help the charter schools. The magnet schools take those children to help the children, and I think that's a big difference.
The first thing I recommend is drinking a lot. If you're gonna take this on, I know I do, and I find it helpful. Framing. So I think you just have to be aware of the most common arguments against doing what's right from a tax policy standpoint, and be ready to counter those. And I would not use very charged rhetoric. I find, once again, maybe this is because I work in a bipartisan organization, or maybe my experience on that federal commission where we had every ideological worldview, right, left, and centrist on education policy represented, and we had to sort of set aside our worldviews and focus on evidence and data. I think charged rhetoric tends to marginalize an issue and make it less likely to pass. So I would frame things in ways that bridge rather than reinforce ideological divides. Let's take today's discussion on corporate loopholes. We never call any of that a loophole. It's a tax expenditure. We are spending through the tax code to achieve a public good, economic development or whatever. But we should evaluate those tax expenditures the same way we evaluate direct expenditures. Are they in fact generating the public good we want? And in the case of the bills you referenced, no, they're not. I mean, these are just things that seem to be benefiting private sector taxpayers, providing no public corresponding public sector benefit. And at a time of scarce resources, why should we be subsidizing companies that ought be taxpayers? So the analysis on those is a pretty simple analysis. It's a tax expenditure that's ineffective. So let's bring that revenue in and spend it on education, health, social services, and public safety, real public good. Everyone that opposes raising tax revenue says it will destroy your economy and hurt jobs and drive out the business or the job creators, right? We've all heard it. None of that's true. And in fact, there are no peer-reviewed research studies which support that contention. So I think being armed with the facts, you could go to our website. We have a sort of a meta-analysis of that research. It's called Good for Business. It's a report that pulls a lot of those other reports in and says, look, There's never been a correlation between a state's tax policy high or low and its economic growth. In fact, the things that matter at the state level that create more economic competitiveness than what you would think a state would have given its share of the GDP and population, et cetera, two things: investments in education and infrastructure. And this the data does prove. We can't invest in either education or infrastructure with our current tax policy. We're revenue poor, and that's the driving problem. These changes to tax policy, which generate about $4.2 billion in revenue, not only won't hurt our economy, they'll allow the state to balance its budget and ultimately make the investments that bring businesses in. That's number one. Number two, even if you're not someone who's naturally predisposed to look at the revenue side of the ledger and think any tax increase could be harmful, put it in context. We have a $720 billion economy. A $4 billion tax increase is less than 1% of the economic activity in Illinois. It's so small in context, it can't be measured by any econometric model at any university. It's too small. How can we let a tax increase too small to be measured stand in the way of investing in education and infrastructure? So these are powerful ways to frame the argument. And you always have to frame the argument tying your tax revenue enhancement to the investments you're going to make in public services. And one thing, you know, it's funny, in this master's class I teach on public budgeting, the politics of taxes is an entire chapter in the book I've chose to use. Every state that has successfully increased its tax system significantly has used education as the tip of the spear in making the argument, right? We need to invest more in our education, and that's a winning argument, and I'll tell you why. Show of hands, who here has children? Anybody in the room? A lot of people have kids, right? All right, show of hands, who here has ever been a kid? Anybody in the room, ever been a child? Well, and see, everyone naturally gets the value of education because we've all gone to school. And it's something that appeals to voters of all stripes. So if you just frame it the right way and stay focused on that's the mission and we can't get there with our current resource base. And then the other stuff is really tax specific stuff, and we could help you with that if you wanted to put together things. So for instance, of the 47 states with the sales tax, we have the most narrow base. All of our neighboring states tax services more than we do. Iowa and Governor Walker's Wisconsin tax every service we think you ought to tax. Have you seen boatloads of people from Iowa and Wisconsin coming here to get their haircut? No, they tax them there, we don't here. Now, if you've seen their haircuts, you should tell them to come, because those are silly looking people. But you can frame these things in ways that are very common sense, very evidence-based, and get past that initial no. And I really appreciate the fact that Representative Lang made it very clear you're gonna hear no before you hear yes. You will. You just gotta stay on it, and you gotta keep going to the well, and ultimately you'll be successful as long as you stay focused on the evidence and non-charged rhetoric.
Remember your question?
How do we stop it? I don't know. Don't ask me, ask the politicians. I mean, one thing though, people need to pay very close attention to things like Chicago Public Schools, especially it's an appointed school board. You know, something like these contracts, these for-profit alternative schools, they were approved with barely, there's like a press release on a Wednesday, and I think they were approved, or Friday, and they were approved that Wednesday. You know, it hardly even gives, you know, anybody enough room to catch their breath. And so that's a big problem.
Our annual meeting a couple weeks ago, we had an interesting speaker, a fellow named Jack Alshuler, who talked about the effect of money in politics and pointed out that nobody's very happy with what they get out of government. And he asked, why aren't we getting what we want out of government? He pointed to a Citizens United type blossoming of both contributions to candidates, but also lobbying, which has just grown exponentially since Citizens United. And I would ask each of you, of course, if you're talking about income taxes or corporate taxes, there's lots of boxes to be bored. So I imagine there's a lot of lobbying, a lot of contributions made to politicians that affect
the discussion that needs to happen in Springfield. So I'd be curious, are there standout organizations or people who are fueling the opposition or fueling the status quo with campaign contributions and lobbying? And can you name them?
Well, what I know is that Stand for Children and Democrats for Education Reform are, they've made a big push in Illinois. They, you know, now with the mayor election, they are every 10 minutes sending out a press release. When Rauner was running, they were very supportive. You know, they are very pro-charter. They have a lot of money behind them.
Well, there's certainly a lot of money in politics. There are certainly lobbyists, and they certainly write campaign checks. But when we're talking about, and there would be those who disagree with me, but when we're talking about education funding, and when we're talking about tax policy, I don't think those lobbyists matter at all. On tax policy in particular, nobody wants to vote to raise your taxes. Democrats don't want to do it. Republicans don't want to do it. Nobody wants to vote to raise your taxes. But when all a legislator thinks about, or all a member of the Chicago City Council thinks about, is how do I get reelected, then public policy takes a backseat to politics. The interesting thing is, for all of the fear in Springfield about the last tax increase when we went from 3% to 5%, for all of that fear, I want you to know this. Not one legislator that voted for that tax increase lost their next election. I want to say this again. They were fearful, and many voted no. But for those who voted yes, not one single member of the House or a single member of the Senate lost their reelection. In fact, Governor Quinn got reelected, or got elected. And so, what does that tell you? That tells you that fear of politics has gotten ahead of public policy in our public debate. That's the real problem, not lobbyists, because in many ways, lobbyists perform a valuable service. I don't mean the checks they give to elected officials, I mean the education process. So when we have a bill on coal mines in Springfield, there aren't too many in our area. I need a lobbyist to come to my office on both sides of a coal mining issue and explain to me who's right and who's wrong, and I have to make a decision. I don't care who gives me a check. What I care about is give me the information. So lobbyists are, there's nothing wrong with lobbyists. There is something wrong with the system where you have a case like Citizens United that allows major corporations to dump all kinds of money on people unfettered, and you have a governor here in the state of Illinois that wants to keep labor unions from making the same donations to people. That's a separate political issue we can talk about some other time. So the big issue in Springfield that gets in the way of a lot of public policy, whether it's tax policy, education policy, healthcare policy, particularly healthcare policy, is election politics. And when we start electing better people who care more about the public good than about election politics, we'll have a better result come out of Springfield, we'll have a better result come out of City Hall, we'll have a better result come out of Washington. Take a look at what goes on in Washington. You want to see dysfunction? Take a good look at what goes on in Washington. So a lot of that in Washington is surely about money. But on some of the things we've been talking about here tonight, I don't think it's money. It's political fear, and it's unwarranted political fear, because no one ever loses an election doing the right thing.
Yeah, what Lou said. And even when we first got the state income tax with the 1970 Constitution, everyone says, well, you know, Walker beat Ogilvie because Ogilvie supported this creation of an income tax we've never had before, and Walker said he was against it. That's not the reason why Walker won. Walker was charming and charismatic and criminal, everything we like in a governor. and
he wasn't a criminal yet.
But I mean, he had the potential, and I think we saw it as a voting public. We saw the potential for criminality. So Ogilvy literally couldn't smile from a war wound. His face was stoic. He couldn't smile. The nerves were going. He couldn't smile. So Walker won because he was far more charismatic and did a great job campaigning across Illinois. Literally, as Lou said, every state rep and every state senator that voted for creating the income tax and ran for re-election got reelected, every single one. And that's been historically the pattern in Illinois. So the fear of doing the right thing on tax policy that many politicians have far outweighs the reality of what the electorate does to them in campaign season. And so I think the important thing, the lesson from that, is to just keep making your case. Because I do think, though, money and lobbyists matter a little bit more in public policy development now than at any other point in our history, so much so that we're moving more towards a participatory democracy than a true representative democracy. So those that have the affluence or the influence to participate generally get represented, and those who stay out of the system don't, which is the message to the grassroots. You either do politics or politics will do you. You have to be engaged. You don't have to have money to have influence. You just have to be engaged. And I think that's how you counter it.
Well, thank you. We have time for one more quick question.
A quick question for Ralph. If re-amortizing the debt is such a no-brainer, why hasn't it been done? What are the arguments that are being made against?
They're all political. So I'll give you the one public policy argument. So if you have an actuarial determination of a payment schedule for your unfunded liability, the debt you owe your pension system, under generally accepted actuarial principles, you're supposed to have it eliminated in 30 years, or at least 80% funded out of 100% funded in 30 years. 80% you're healthy under CBO regulations. We can't. We can't pay the debt we owe our pension systems in 30 years. In fact, we've accrued it over 70 years. Paying it off in 30 years just isn't possible. In fact, even if we eliminate, go back to the temporary tax increase and put those rates back in, even if we did that, we'd have to cut spending on education, health, social services, and public safety by over 40% over the next 30 years to fund the current ramp on pensions. Not only are we not going to do that, we ought not do that. That would be horrible public policy. So the only policy argument is you're supposed to do it in 30 years. But since this debt was created over such a longer period of time, and that's not practical, and the same tax dollars that fund your pension debt fund those four core services, you need a more practical approach. The more practical approach is to extend it out a few years, like I said, 13 years, get to this level dollar amount and stay there. So instead of having a pension payment that jumps like this every single year over and above inflation and all your other costs that your tax system can't afford, it's flat. So over time, all revenue growth goes to current services. It's a real powerful thing to do, and it takes the pressure off. And I think the only political objection to it has been, and there's been two. One, it doesn't punish union members for those Cadillac benefits that somebody's imagination thinks they have. They do not have Cadillac benefits, and that's overplayed. But seriously, it's what a lot of the voting public think. So a lot of people in the General Assembly believe you have to attack the benefits to appear credible on the issue to the voting public. So that's a political problem. And the other political problem is folks don't want to be accused of kicking the can down the road. So since you can't do it in 30 years, since it takes 43, they're saying, oh, we're going to get accused of that. Well, no, you're not. You're going to actually solve the problem. But those are the hurdles that we come up against in the discussion. It's literally the only way to do it that's constitutional and affordable. And we've run the numbers, and they've been peer reviewed by the actuaries at the retirement systems, actually. They hate it because it doesn't do it in 30 years, but they agree it works. By 30 years from now, instead of being 100% funded, the systems would be roughly 76, 78% funded, right in that range, which is almost healthy. And that accounts for all the cash flow obligations of the systems to pay benefits to current and future retirees too. So it literally works. And it's the only constitutional thing on the table. So hopefully we can get past these couple of political hurdles. Gee, we got to take on benefits because of this public perception. And gee, I don't want to be accused of kicking the can down the road. Those are the sort of political things we got to take on.
Thank you very much. I think I can easily say this is a very impressive panel and very impressive discussion. I wish it could go on longer. You probably don't. You're probably a little tired. But I thank you very much. Let's give the panel a hand.